excited about today. I just got done a book signing at Barnes and Nobles in downtown Phoenix. So I'm back home on my pool deck. That's my office. So I'm happy to be here in 70 degrees. I'm not sure where you guys are at.
Yeah, we're down in South Florida.
Oh, you're good then.
Yeah, we're not. I'm originally from Michigan, so I had to get out of that cold.
It looks like you're wearing flannel.
Yeah,
He just wanted to get fancy for you.
yeah, I had to dress up.
Right.
Got a nice
Well,
shirt.
it makes me feel like home from Vermont. So
Yeah.
thanks.
He'll start to sweat soon, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Right.
We got the
Yeah.
fan on. So
I
here, just
bet.
wait a couple more minutes till everyone jumps in. We went on Periscope and we're bringing people, and some people should pop up, and
Okay.
we're
Yeah,
excited
I
about.
shared it on my Facebook and social media with the time I had today anyway. So I
Cool. We got
expect
a
a
few
few
people.
stragglers.
Eileen and Tom just joined. Hey guys,
Yeah,
thanks
so
for.
if Robert, if you look over on the right of your screen, people can comment and ask questions,
Oh,
and then at the end of
wait
the
one of
interview, if
those.
anybody wants, they can actually jump on live video with us
Oh, I see.
ask
Okay.
live questions and join the conversation. So we think it's a pretty cool platform.
We got Stephen
Yeah,
Covert.
it's
Hi,
kind of new
Stephen.
to me, so bear with me.
Yeah, no, it's
Looks.
great. There's actually four slots, so four people can get live on the same
Right.
screen at once, and people can
So cool.
hop on and off, like anyone watching, if they decide they want to come on and ask questions or contribute somehow. Like, it's like this fun interactive site.
Yeah.
We think it's real
And
cool.
that is so funny because it's one of my big things when I talk around the country. I'm, not it, to no offense to the folks who like to stand up and hear themselves talk, but I have an interactive dialogue. I try to, by the time you leave a seminar with me, you've almost met everybody in the room and connected with them on a number of different levels through how I take them through. So you just can't help but, it's just been such a calling of mine anyway, this oneness, this connectivity. And if I can be an instrument to connect others, that's to me, one of the purposes I found.
Yeah, and even someone just asked a question. Steve just asked, did you experience oneness? And we could really just get into it. So this is Jason and Aaron from vibrationupgrade.com, and we have Robert Tremblay from 20-seconds.net, and he has a book called 20 Seconds, and it goes over his near-death experience. And we set up this interview today to really, dive deep into what you experienced and how that opened up into,
Sure.
sounds
And
like
I'm glad I can, instead of just telling the story, I can answer questions as it goes. I think you find it just kind of pieces itself together. To answer Stephen's question, that was the most profound part that I came back with, whether it was intuitive or a calling, if you will. But in that dark area I was, where that large ball of light with that man's face, you could almost taste the oneness, if that's an analogy. It was never so clear to me. And growing up as an athlete, and I understood teamwork and coaching and the positive attitudes, but this was more than that. This was a purity of oneness that was absolutely defined without question. So it's a really great question, Stephen, and I think it brings up right into the conversation of the after effects, and it is a number percentage of near-death experiencers who've been studied have said that that was the single most profound piece of their experience. So,
Yeah.
excellent question to lead off.
Yeah, that's interesting too. And I've been doing some just reading on people. They're doing some research in Mexico and with dimethyltryptamine, which is actually a chemical released in your pineal gland when you're in deep REM sleep. And then also there's a big release in death and in near-death experiences. And people, when they travel to that other side, they feel like the connection of oneness and that the realization. A lot of people come back from the experience and say the realization that we're all one and we're
Yeah.
down in, in this low density.
It's very astute of you. And I, synchronistically, serendipitously, most of my book is about that being what probably saved me.
Right.
And it, you know, it, and I don't want it to sound corny. I was a, you know, I wasn't the whole emotional man in touch with my feminine side by any means. I was an egotistical jerk, but I didn't have time for these things, to be honest with you. But it was, it's never been so profound in my life that, you know, the attitude I took going into it and the collaborative that helped me survive, you know, the question continued to haunt me. Was it love? Is it just that simple? You know, I did it without an immune system. It still defies medical knowledge. And I don't want to oversimplify it. And maybe it is just that simple. And, you know, some of my book talks about new science out now that talks about the caregivers and the nurturers and our responsibility in healing our loved ones. And, you know, I get the crisis that comes up with the failing health of people we love. I think most people in our world have experienced it. And I think some have packaged it into a scary, you know, death for me as a kid anyway, was a crying, hysterical fit of, oh, by the way, I got to see all my relatives I never saw. And it just a weird overtone to a funeral. And I, you know, conditioning being what it is, you grow up differently. But, you know, that for us, you know, the 11 to 15 million near-death experiencers are the absolute definitive highest percentage of similarity in our stories is we've lost our fear of death. And in doing so, maybe found a different way to live. And, you know, there's a lot that try to jam it down your throat. There's, you know, I just wanted to tell the story. It was important for me to thank members of my family, friends, and loved ones who helped carry me. And then, bang, we run into a disease that simply requires the same collectivity of human consciousness, the same gathering that helped save me, that has helped make teams successful, helped make countries successful. That oneness that Stephen mentioned earlier, it just seems so natural to me that surely people will want to be involved. And unfortunately, you know, my cause is a cause we've kind of brushed aside a little bit, I think, in our society and maybe put into a drawer that was just not our circus, maybe not our monkeys. And I know I did. And I'll speak on that behalf that, you know, my risk of HIV infections as a heterosexual male, I just didn't even consider it. And I lived and made mistakes. But there were lessons to these my mistakes. And I think they're important. And in a time where the disease has actually evolved now to, you know, 40% nearly are females ages 13 to 24. And, you know, you talk about that and most people have no clue what you're even saying. So, you know, it was never about, you know, for me, the gay lives matter. They absolutely matter, but every life matters. And the only way to effectively make a conscious choice in our world is by collecting every single member, black, white, gay. I don't care. It just can't be labeled into a separate group as their issue, because I'm sorry, most of humanity just ignores the rest of it. And it's, we're busy. It's just the way of life. But if we grab the world by the throat and said, this can happen and is happening to your daughters. And in the United States, 60% of those young ladies don't even know they're infected. Now, we don't need to have math graphs here, but in 5 years, that population triples. Those women are in childbearing years. And this is what we want to talk about. You know, we don't want to discredit the transgender gay population. We're not trying to be offensive to any one population. We're trying to unite all of us. And some of my near-death experience bringing some different aspects into it as well.
No, I agree. Yeah. Sure. And even Daryl just asked, so you maybe even if you want to get into your near-death experience and go over that with the audience, and he's asking, you know, did that near-death experience strengthen your belief in a God?
And a little bit about, you know, the illness. You know, you had the cancer as well. Didn't you have like a few episodes of cancer and things like leading up to that point?
Yeah.
Maybe I now,
Yeah, I've now had 8 surgeries in 3 years to remove one carcinoma or another. But, you know, again, one of the disadvantages of having an immune system of non-functioning, it doesn't mean that I don't have issues. It's just ironic that I keep healing things without the use of medications, and I just get through them somehow, and it's weird, and I kind of laugh my way through it. And, you know, a month ago we had MRSA, and I was already on antibiotics for something else. And, you know, my body just always tells me, kid, stay away from them. You know, it's almost like it's just, it goes haywire when I put something new into my system. So to answer the question of, did it strengthen my belief in God? You know, for the first 2 years after my experience of seeing a man's face in a bright ball of light over an endless expanse of peace and harmony, I thought I had reached out and touched the face of God. And I suspected for the 2 years that I carried that thought and those words that were spoken, I truly believe that I had been saved by God to do something important. I still do. You know, those were the only words exchanged between me and this man of light, in this ecstatic, brilliant, peaceful, harmonic environment that I had never, that seemed realer than today. And he asked if I was ready, and I specifically said no. And in a time in my other life, I had already given up. So it was very odd, but I was very definitive. No. And he said, there's something important I'm supposed to do. He smiled. I reached out and touched him, and I felt like my teeth vibrated out of my head and it exploded in this white light. And, you know, the rest is in the book. But so was there a strengthening of God? You bet. But the irony of the story, and I'm not sure if I should ruin it in the book, is who that man in the light ended up being some almost 3 years later at Christmas time, right around the time my father died. It was when we discovered who that man in that light was. So, and I'll cough it up here, but it's, you know, part of the holy cow of the book, too.
Well, so Daryl wants to know, before you give it away, did he look like Brad Pitt?
Did God look like Brad Pitt? Just no. Kidding.
He looked like Charlton Heston, and long flowing hair to his shoulders that was grayish and wavy, but not curly, and no facial hair, but weathered. And just, who's the guy who plays like on Roadhouse, Sam, somebody that he's got the deep voice and the, you know, the crazy mustache, Sam Elliott. Yeah. Kind of like that face, weathered and experienced. When I looked at his face, you absolutely believed whatever's going to come out of your mouth. You've been there. I'm sure of it. You know, first of all, you're in a ball of light. So, you know, it just, it was so funny and peaceful that, yeah, the God thing has been clear, but maybe a little bit different than what I grew up with in my belief of a single holy being.
Yeah. And even, and then Stephen wanted to know if the experience was similar to the stillness during a meditation.
Yeah. You know, great question. I think a lot of people get hung up on meditation, you know, the definition, I should say, of meditation. And one of our issues in this world is we're so busy defining things. So in my meditation, it's different. And I've had to stay away from the Buddhist meditation because I do feel like I'm losing, or I have a choice of entering that type of, and it freaks me out. So, and I'd love to say I'm brave and courageous, but frankly, that freaks me out. So yes, it does bring you there. I have experimented with recreating my experience, and I've come pretty close once. Yeah. And it scared me. And it was in that event that I discovered spirits, and not all of them are pleasant and friendly. And, a crazy accident, getting thrown down a flight of stairs. And so I have a fairly general respect for, you know, I came back with a lot of psychic things. I didn't like any of them. And I've spent the better part of 3 years running from them. And I get one thing to be true. I'm not going to be able to run forever. And I know they're important to me somehow, but I'm trying to find pace in dealing with after effects and getting assimilated into normal life. You know, I'm not the guy handing out daisies at the airport here, but I am standing up telling people, maybe it's just about how much we love each other. Is it just that crazy? But, you know, I don't have an MD after my name either, so it's a little more difficult. But that's how my story's caught popularity, been in the top 1% on Amazon ever since its release. It's been one person at a time picking up the baton and saying, this is important to talk about. If this man's going to bare his soul, then damn it, we're going to make an impact with women 13 to 24. In fact, every population. It is not a scary thing to get tested for HIV. It takes 20 seconds of your time. You're done. You're gone. But man, if I had ever spread my disease, it would be a whole different story. And that's just the simple fact of it. You know, there's a lot of things to tackle in HIV, but we could literally stop it with human consciousness. And no offense, I call the BS on that. You know, if we're that busy, that's impossible. This society, this, you know, we donate a dollar for every book we sell to a charity to help advocate and make young kids aware in colleges and universities, especially. And we ask people to donate a dollar too. And that part's been, it's been rough. And I get it. You know, it's not a sexy breast cancer-ish kind of hoorah. But I think when we get past that stigma of it, we can make an impact. And I just want to put a real face on it.
Yeah. Did you have any of those psychic abilities before the near-death experience, or was that something that appeared once that happened?
I guess I would say I had some experiences in the military in dangerous situations where I had a intuitive belief that made me choose differently that probably made impacts. So fantastic question. I guess I just didn't understand what was happening. You know, when I was in police work, going through a building, hunting some perpetrator, I had a sixth sense of knowing where he was in the building. It sounds weird, but it just,
I don't think that's weird.
I think everybody has that. You know, it's just a matter of being in that emotional situation to discover them. And certainly, you know, with a gun out as a cop running through a dark warehouse, you suddenly start finding senses you may not have even considered. So it was a lot like that. But, you know, when it first happened, I didn't understand that I'd had a near-death experience. I didn't know these things were normal. I thought I was losing my mind. So it became a passion to me to talk about the after effects of a near-death experience. Yes, so many people are craving the answer and they go right to the story. And I get it. We're a society that loves the story and the drama. But it's so funny, people, when it comes to the synchronized, timed, exact after effects we all go through, that's the proof we need to talk about. And, you know, but we still kind of gravitate towards that light and, you know, you can share it all you want. I suspect the truth is until you've experienced it, it's just nothing more than a story.
Is one of the common after effects increased intuitiveness or psychic abilities?
Yeah. You know, the energy of the world. I never once even pondered what energy was other than I turned on my TV. You know, the fact that our basic cellular biology is based on an energetic pattern of fight or flight or positive balance. That's exactly how cells work, right down to the very cell in your body. So, you know, if your cell is in a fearful fight or flight state, it does not grow. There's no reason to grow if you're running from a lion. It actually robs blood from the brain. It makes you dumber when you're scared. And one of the most profound things coming back was that losing that fear. And there was such a taste to me at first that this whole fear deal, there's something wrong there. This is a society issue, and it stinks to high heaven. And I'm not a big conspiracy theory guy, but I'm telling you, almost everything comes back to fear in this world. And don't think our consumer people, marketing, and our politicians have figured it out. And it disgusts me. If we understood how remarkable we were when we are not in a fear-based state, our cells hum a different resonance. It causes intent. It makes things happen. But so too does your thought when you're worrying about something.
Right.
And you will manifest what you think about. And fear is nothing more than halting our progress as a society.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how to fix it. And I don't pretend to, but this one particular issue of getting tested for HIV, that is the single one aspect that can make the biggest dent, which in 20 something years, we haven't even dented HIV. It's gotten worse. Mm-hmm. So it's time to get everybody involved. So we're asking everybody to give a buck. That was the intention. We called it Gab. Yes. So we made Gab gear, and let's gab about it, and we gab everywhere we can. Gab, 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 gab. And we're gabbing until we're exhausted sometimes. So, but you know, everywhere we go, we meet people like you and these people hammering on the questions, none of which I can see, by the way.
Oh,
so
you can't
if there's
see
other
the questions?
Questions,
you can't see them.
I'm sorry.
You can't see the questions on the side.
It seems like they're coming really fast.
I know in your book or in a previous interview, you mentioned that, you know, that white light, that face said, you know, are you ready? And you said, no. And then wasn't there another or that same voice that said, there's something important that you have to do?
And yeah, those were the only words exchanged. And then it's weird because it wasn't a lip moving thing. So at first it was like, did I just say that? And so it was really strange, but those were the only words. And, you know, back in the bed that I was in, I was 36 days into a 30-day life expectancy. So I had given up. I had been transported back to Vermont because that's where I wanted to die. And, you know, that hospital felt they could save me. But, you know, it's funny, people, why were you terminal? Why were you terminal? I was terminal for the reason everybody's terminal. And it isn't about a disease. I had given up. I was done. I was shamed of that disease. I had no hope. And that experience happened at exactly the right time. But those were the words spoken. And the carrot I chase every day, that what is the important, you know, you thinking, at first I'm thinking, this is heaven. You guys can't be more specific here. You know, you can't sing is there a harp song, or you don't have post-it notes.
Like,
but it's been a comical chase. I don't think it's one singular thing. It's, yeah. I honestly, truly believe the answer. I finally figured it out. It's just every day waking up and saying thanks for one more day.
Yeah. And living in your highest excitement and spreading what makes you happy and your story and bringing more people to connection with their spirituality and oneness.
Well, you know, whatever this book does, you know, being in the top 1% in Amazon, I'd love to say it's because I'm a genius writer. Or I'd love to take the accolades, but it's been the collective of people. You know, there's 20, 30 people on here now. If each one of them shares a post, buys the book, donates a dollar, who cares about the dollar? But the dollar says I get it. And I'm going to take some responsibility in talking about it. They could buy Gab gear. They could, you know, I make $1.78 selling a book. I donate $1 to charity. So this is about giving back to people just like I was, who didn't know what they were going to do. You know, my medication costs almost $5,800 a month. and 90 days without it, I'm not here. It's a bit humility oriented for me to maybe try to make a difference for some folks out there.
No, that's great. And yeah, even Daryl said most near-death experiencers don't become more religious, but definitely more spiritual.
And yeah.
That's his having his dance music in it. So
he's totally spot on. I've not met anybody who, and I know hundreds, if not thousands of experiencers now that have an organized religion. They certainly believe in their God, but they worship in the way that their conscience tells them to. And, you know, that religious aspect is, as the old saying goes, that's somebody else's story. Spirituality, that's my story. That's where I discovered my magnificence. And to be honest, in our book, I'm outside, by the way, so occasionally we'll get a plane.
Are you in an airplane?
No, I'm by the pool deck, so I get an occasional buzz over. Probably from the Mexican border, or who knows. It's a little crazy down here in Arizona. But that spirituality that happened to me, you know, it's really the only issue or position I try to take in the book. You know, I don't tell people this was God, this was this, this is that, this is what heaven is. I don't tell them how to do anything. I just give them the information and I encourage them to engage themselves in the book, to listen to their voice, what pops up while you're reading things and why, and write them down and create your own experience. Because I, you know, it's at moments in the now when you're engaged in something very emotional, we open up naturally to that expressway of spirituality and things will pop into your head. You have no idea where they came from. It's like when you're in the shower, you know, it's in the now. If you are doing nothing but concentrating on the now, your cells are just popping and the energy of the world is coming to you. So it's at those moments that I encourage. And I think a lot of readers found, we did a study the other day, almost 75% of the people who read the book read it more than once. And we thought, wow, that's weird. But, you know, there's a lot of things to it, I guess. You know, it's the first part of it's deeply personal and horrendous. And, yeah. You know, we hope that shock value is everybody knew about my near-death experience and my healing. What they didn't know is, you know, I was diagnosed with end-stage AIDS and did it all without an immune system. That's the really remarkable part of it.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Silverdale just asked a question. As an after effect, do you connect daily or stay connected to that light?
I have to. You know, I stopped chasing the light, I guess, when I realized, and I say this all the time, and I don't mean this to sound egotistical at all, but I stopped chasing the light when I realized I was it. Mm-hmm. So I don't care how you meditate. I don't care where you find your light, whether it's in a closet or in the great outdoors or by a shimmering lake. Sunsets and sunrises are my deal. I go out of my way to catch everyone. And it's in that moment that I just say thank you. And you can literally, I can almost hear my cells go, it's just breathing and being in the now in a beautiful moment. And it was everything.
You're right.
I continue it to this day, but that's my connection. But I encourage others. It doesn't have to be a meditative state. Just being in the now. Preferably somewhere beautiful, peaceful, and lovely is better. But I know people who can meditate with rock music earbuds. So whatever works for you and puts you into a calming state of mind. But think while you're doing it, you know, the things that come into your mind, can I do anything about them? Nope. I picture them like a balloon and I just let them go. And that's what I do every day.
No, you're right. And it's hard to stay in the now because you get so distracted thinking about the past or the future and what you have to do tomorrow and the next day. You can't stay in the now and actually enjoy what's around you, enjoy sunsets, enjoy the people you with, and you got to snap your brain back into it.
Well, you know, I was chasing the American dream for a very long time. And somewhere along the line, my American dream got defined as money. And I think for a good number of people, it still is. And I get it. It takes the wheel to go around, but it's, I just found that, you know, all of my life I've been manifesting things, and I think we all have. And I think it's important to tell people that, you know, look, if this part is true, and I think science has shown it, that what you think about actually happens, starts to become whole. Your intent, your emotion, and your action fuel it. But I think it's important we start remembering that thoughts are energy. Mm-hmm. And take some responsibility for it. I think that's the issue.
No, you're right. And we're big into a couple channelers, Bashar and Cryon and Abraham Hicks, and they all talk about that same thing. You know, the reality is just a reflection of yourself and your thoughts and what you believe and manifesting it.
You know, it's really hard to go onto a stage with 200 people and say almost everything going on in your own mind is your own perception and under your own control. There's no future in it. People will stand up and walk out. They don't want to hear that. I probably would have too back then, but man, one thing we're studying now is the spontaneous remission report. It's 3,500 of the most medically noted cases in the world of spontaneous remission. They're undisputed. Now, obviously there's more than 3,500, but these are the best, most documented cases.
Yeah.
And what we're finding in our research is we're not ready to publish it yet, but almost 95% so far of those people had some sort of spiritual awakening to cause that healing. Is that important to talk about? I get it. The pharmaceutical industry is $350 billion a year. If that fails, we're done as a society. But there's a way we can do this together. You know, the placebo, the nocebo effect that we're studying now, finally, people are understanding that we have a little bit more power than we thought.
You talked about a lot of the healing energy from your caregivers. I heard you say, you know, being around your family and the positive people, heal people. So you felt like that played a big role in healing your...
Interestingly, it seemed like, you know, one of the biggest common denominators. So I kept focusing, just kept coming up intuitively. And so I ran into some, you know, and what's this placebo all about? And, you know, it just, all these medical things kept popping into your brain and you're like, well, I never cared about these things. So anyway, I'd go research these crazy theories I've had 1,000 times a day and find out, thank God, somebody else thought of them. But, you know, I never cared about these things before. So it was very pushing me. But interestingly, some people have started studying the placebo effect. Mm-hmm. We have every drug trial goes through a placebo effect. Everybody knows that. It's part of federal law. The question is, we've done 1/1,000th of the study on what a placebo effect even is. So we put it into every medication test, but we really don't even understand it. How's that work? So I don't even know how the pharmaceutical industry allowed that, but they did. So now people are going, let's talk more about the placebo and the nocebo, which is very well unknown. And, you know, we're in a world of, last night I watched the evening news, God help me, but I did. You know, I like to keep informed without all the negativity, but
the news is full of fear.
Oh, it's awful. But there were six ads for shingles. And I just thought to so I got on the computer and shingles have increased almost 40% in the last 2 years. Do you notice the similarity? You started seeing all these commercials, a couple of years ago? It's incredible. Epigenetics has really attacked the caregiver nurture aspect and given doctors and nurses a back door. It's not that we don't need medical professions. You're critical. If we believe you, we heal. But when we walk in and you say, boy, that's going to kill you. You're snapping my DNA is what you're doing. And if I believe you, I'm going, my inner self-conscious is going to allow it to happen. And I think, God, it's so touchy of a conversation to have, to think we're responsible for making other people sick. But it brings to us one conditional point, and it goes back to kindergarten. If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. And I think when we get back to that basic thing, we won't be flipping genes with other people. But here's something interesting Harvard University just came out with. They told people they were giving them a placebo during this recent study this year. And they said, because we respect you this much, we respect your power that much. Well, the person getting the medication felt so empowered that they were cared for to this degree, they healed at a faster rate. So the results were, the placebo didn't just have a 60% effect, 60% greater than the medications alone. It was the caregiver or nurturer who gave the medication from the beginning was where the original intent, power of the energy in the mind, that's where the healing began and ended. So here comes a situation where many people do what when people are sick? Right? You might have done it. It's not easy watching that. I get it. But look at the difference we can make. Mm-hmm. Even just 20 seconds, phone call. You can do it. We love you. I got all of these 20-second moments all the time from people, and still do. Sharing a post, telling about the book, you know, calling Oprah. I have like 10 people every week writing Oprah. And it's not for me. It's for our daughters. It's for our children. And I'm done being quiet about it.
We have quite a few questions coming in. Let's pick the connection to epigenetics.
Yeah.
Science. Peter says, what is the connection to epigenetics?
Oh, you know, if anybody hasn't read Bruce Lipton's work, Bruce Lipton was the original cellular biologist who cloned sheep DNA. So this guy's no dummy. But today he's now written books on epigenetics, which is indicating, I'm sorry about this, because we've spent so much money on DNA research. DNA carries this. It's gonna, if that's in your DNA, you're gonna get it. That's not true. And now we've invested so much money on DNA science that the DNA scientists are pushing back, saying, well, we can't tell people that. Here's the deal. Bruce Lipton discovered that the cell wall, the membrane, was the brain of the cell, not the nucleus. You could live without a nucleus of a cell. But the membrane of the cell, every one of your cells gets feedback from your brain to tell it, what is it in danger? Is it in peace? Is it in harmony?
Mm-hmm.
It was never the DNA that snapped your whatever disease that your mom carried, is what the science is saying. It was your belief that it's going to happen, kicked on the gene.
Yeah.
Now they're even experimenting with kicking off the gene, and they're seeing it. You know, science can't look at DNA and say 90% is junk. That dog doesn't hunt. Just because we don't know what it is, it doesn't mean we need to call it junk. And dark matter, it's dark matter. You don't know what it is, so you're going to call it dark matter. Come on, just admit. I think one of the biggest things I had to admit in my change as a human being was that I might have always been wrong. Always. And the raw fact that if you're flexible in life, you know, open-minded, not so open-minded your brain falls out, but be open-minded and trust your gut. You're missing, you know, just look at the electromagnetic spectrum. Light, we see less than 1% that we know of.
Yeah.
We see, feel, touch less than 4% of the electromagnetic spectrum we know of. And people still go, yeah, ghosts don't exist.
And we're, really? We're the only people in the entire universe.
I know.
And we can't see, you know, 95%.
I'm just going to walk through life in my comfort zone in my 4%. And you know what? Some people, that's okay. They're not ready for the 93, but I mean, just add 2 or 3 more percent and understand this, that to me, one of the greatest gifts coming back was that I can communicate with my past loved ones anytime, anywhere, at any time, at any place. They are there guiding me every second of every day, and I feel them. I sometimes see them. I don't talk about seeing them because I don't want to get locked up. So there's a lot of things that go on that we have to, you know, assimilate into the normal world. But if someone asks me, I try to answer. But I do babble.
That's a gift for everybody, too. Everyone has loved ones and spirit guides all around them. The majority of people just don't know it.
You know, yeah. I got to believe it just makes death easier knowing that they're standing right there. All you got to do is talk to them. But here's the deal. When you're in that world, I think one thing you can't handle in the afterlife is pain. So while your loved ones are crying and deep, imagine a world of peace and beauty. You're watching this. What do you do? I have no idea. So it doesn't mean crying and grieving is bad. It just means I wonder how it affects the spirit world. They're all right there.
Yeah, no, it is interesting. When you had that near-death experience and you were on, you know, in that white light, did you feel like you remembered where you were? Did it feel familiar?
It felt very comfortable and very peaceful. Yeah. There was a vibration, a humming, kind of almost like a river in the background, roaring, humming, and it changed pitches, you know, and the color of the red ribbon that looked like a volcano at first, there were so many peaceful things rolling into me. None of it was scary at all. There was no hesitation. I felt like the last day of school, you know, when you run out the door, like it just that and that breeze, that was a big one. Having that breeze that smelled like, you know, that breeze, you smell that every once in a while and go, wow, life is good. It was like, it was like drowning in it. It just, it's the best way to describe it.
I have a question for you. When you came out of that, you know, 20-second near death experience, could you feel your body and your cells like healing and feeling stronger almost immediately when you came out of it?
Instantaneously, ironically. I mean, it took a while to heal, but when I arrived in Vermont, I was in and out of basically a coma. I was in and out of consciousness. I had given up. I was so weak. I just slept all day. So when I came back after the light and, you know, something important you're supposed to do and touching him, and I felt like I exploded. I woke up immediately in my bed and I sat up straight, absolutely with it. And I demanded to see every one of my doctors. They all came in and they all stared at me saying, you know, this man was drooling for the last 5 days in a coma. So what has happened? And I went around the room and asked them all, and I told them, before we start, I'm going to ask all of your opinion. And they're looking at me like, what is happening? I need to know what your true belief is on whether you can save me. And there's something important I'm supposed to do. So you go ahead and start first. And they went around the room, each of them looking at me like, and I heard nothing but positives. And maybe that's all I wanted to hear. And from then on, I noticed immediately that everything was comical or funny, or, you know, I just laughed about it. And I tried to get through it with my sister and laughing things through.
And you also mentioned your personality changed. How did it change?
You know, I was a really judgmental, shallow jerk, frankly. You know, my life was about chasing women and making money, you know, and no offense, fellas that are out there doing it. It's, you know, we grow up doing it. I don't know, you know, you got to get married and chase girls and get married and, you know, but instantaneously, I went from the former police officer, private detective, judgmental to everybody has a gift for me and not just one. And it's just how fast I label that person determines whether or not I shut off my energy between those two souls. And the minute you label or define something, the curiosity stops. It no longer feeds you. So I try to keep that in my memory banks all the time and allow people to evolve before me. But I have a definitive belief that we all cross paths for a reason. It's mm-hmm. just free will and time that determines whether or not we impact each other's lives. And it's okay. It has to be okay. Life is busy.
Yeah, synchronicity is pretty fascinating when you and then when you start to pay attention to it, it almost becomes like comical. Yeah.
Yeah, we laugh still all the time. Something will pop up and I'll say it and Carol, and there it goes, it happens. So we joke and you just have to. But you know, that was one of the fun things with the book, was explaining all the synchronicities that happen that are just like, come on. Yeah, I even remember saying, come on. You know, a couple times I remember, what are you trying to tell me? You know, it was that, you know, the after effects were that pouring and I thirsted for knowledge. Interestingly, never on near-death experience. It was always on quantum physics and science and crap I didn't care about. And I guess I love that stuff and I don't understand it, but so there's another one, you know, that was a big one. But the big thing I noticed at first was I was very, very childlike. Everything was new to me. From a blade of grass to the buds outside my window, I was fascinated with growth and peace and beauty and light. I couldn't get away from light. And I couldn't even go in the sunlight for a while and I couldn't stand it. You know, just light just drew me all the time. Still does. So
you went from women and money to nature and love and being around people and laughter. And
You know, all the people I picked on, you know, in my race to the top, everywhere I went, I just, my mission in life was to be good at whatever I chose as a career. And when I got done getting to the top, I chose a different career and a different challenge. And that's how I lived my life. And I believed always, and I think it's important, that new experiences were the key to evolving as a human being. And that comfort zone, you know, that I kept hearing about just didn't fit in with me. It never did. And ironically, I find now that maybe that comfort zone could be some of the issue for a lot of us that aren't evolving or expanding. You know, you just do the same things over and over. You just get the same thing. So it's until you change those dynamics, nothing changes.
When you have that awakening, it's almost like you start to see, you know, people, nature, everything around you becomes, like you said, this new thing you didn't appreciate before, seeing it with new eyes.
Yeah.
So that, I think that's where that childlike thing comes in, because you're like, oh, wow.
And that oneness, you know, ties into that you start realizing that blade of grass contains the same energy that I have in my molecules. And then you start tinkering and find out, you know, you can manipulate these things. These are, you know, you've got all these things I missed, you know, everything became peaceful. I stopped judging people. Mm-hmm. It was crazy. You know, that thirst for knowledge on all these crazy topics, that was concerning. I mean, I couldn't sleep for weeks because I had to understand epigenetics. Like, I'd never heard of it, but it called me. It just called me. And I still get them all the time. And now I exercise free will to not spend my day researching things that I'll never figure out. So lots of questions still coming in.
I know, I just want to scan quickly. The questions kind of scan through. So anyone who has a question that's still, you're still really wanting to bring up, go ahead and type it again.
We can also,
here it is.
We can also let someone in and chat with us. If you're down for that, Robert.
Does anyone want to come up on the screen? We got two spots. If you guys have anything you want to come contribute or ask Robert, show us your face and hang out. So feel free. How would they do it?
They just click on open seat. Here we go.
Oh,
Daryl.
Daryl. It feels like a knock-knock, like an internet knock-knock. Hey.
Knock, knock.
Daryl.
Hi, Daryl. Hi,
Doug. Hey, nice to meet you.
Yeah, pleasure. One thing I found intriguing about these near-death experiences from what I've researched is that unlike hallucinations, these very short experiences, you know, that rarely go a few minutes, seem to have such a massive change in a person's lifestyle, you know, coming right down from like their convictions to their ideologies and, right, and who they are. And hallucinations just don't have that power to do that.
Right.
And
that was what I always called it too, was, you know, prior to death, you know, any knowledge of near death experience I had was always the life flashing before your eyes, you know, so that was my whole, and I thought it was a hallucination too. And even, you could even say after my experience, as vivid as it was, you could even still call it a hallucination, but Daryl, you're right. It's what happened afterwards that's really the compounding issue that needs to be looked at and studied.
And I find it equally fascinating that it always seems to have a theme of morality, you know, like whatever people are chasing in their lives, you know, like previously you were saying you were chasing money and success. It always seems to come down to like love and helping other people seems to be like the major point of life.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, when I spent 40 something years thinking me, and you know, I wasn't completely selfish. I had a wife and was a good provider, but it, you know, the better cars, the better house, the better life, the better vacations. And man, I you know, I remember in hospice rocking in a chair or looking out the window one day thinking, how many people of all the jobs I've had, how many of those people are going to be at my funeral? You know what I mean? In other words, I never wished I'd spent more time working.
Did you find the experience to be like more real than real? Because I hear that a lot.
Yeah. You know, this to me is not real as that was. And that is very, very hard to describe.
That's exactly what I hear. I hear analogies like that's like the real world. And this world is like more almost like super meshy by comparison.
I think that's an unlimited world and the possibilities are endless. And I don't want people to think I'm running for it or excited for it, but I can't wait. And I don't want that to sound weird. You know I can make I can help people from that side. I know I can. So I'm not afraid of it. And I can't wait for the potential. I'm speechless about the potential of what's there.
Yeah. Well, I think you're very fortunate to have this experience. I'm gonna tap out and give someone else a chance to talk to you directly. But thanks for your time. I really appreciate it.
It was really nice chatting with you, Daryl. Thank you very much for calling in.
And then Michael's asking, was it all encompassing like a euphoric experience? And I think you just talked about that, Robert. And it sounds like it was. Like you said, more real than this experience.
Yeah.
We got another call in.
Euphoria, I think if I can mention it, because it's interesting that you bring up that word. The euphoria actually happens every day afterwards. I know. I hope that's not evading your question, Michael. I felt that experience was the realest thing I ever experienced. The very moment I woke up was where it became euphoric, and every day to this day still is.
Hey, Neil, thanks for joining. Neil, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you fine.
Hey, welcome. Welcome, welcome.
You got a question for Robert, Neil?
His screen might be frozen.
Might have froze.
Yeah.
You frozen, Neil?
All right, Neil. We got to let you go.
You're kind of frozen, but you can try to come back if you...
We got Michael now.
How fun is this?
This is cool.
It's a party. It's a blab near-death experience party.
It's a gab blab.
Right, gab blab. I like it.
All right, we got Michael Dove.
Hey, Michael, you there?
Michael, we can't hear you.
Or see you.
Oh,
he's coming.
Oh, he's processing. Oh you're dark. Oh, there you are. Hi, Michael. Nice to meet
you. Yeah, sorry. You, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, cool. No, I just you struck a chord. It wasn't to do with me. It was to do with my mother, actually, who she had a brain tumor a couple of years ago, and she nearly died. And while she was going through the experience, she was in and out of coherence, and we thought she was going to die, obviously, and it was a big tumor in her head, size of an orange, and it was a 50-50 operation for her to survive. And she was very incoherent at the time, you know, obviously, you know, the tumor had obviously affected her brain and her ability to communicate. And but we witnessed, you know, her consciousness or lack of it, or her diving in and out of consciousness at the time, prior to the operation. And then fortunately for us, you know, she survived the operation, and she's made a really sort of 85% recovery, able to hold, you know, great conversation. You know, she's still recovering 18 months later. But at no time did she say that she was, she had this experience that you say. Mm-hmm. So I was just wondering what that means to you.
Well, there's a lot of people who may not remember their experiences. They may not have gotten an experience. You know, were there any mannerism changes for your mom afterwards?
For the better? Yeah. Well, I mean, her health, her ability to communicate was a slow decline prior to her her becoming ill.
Yes.
Because obviously the tumor was there for many years. It obviously grew over time. You know, we're not sure how long it was there. But at the, you know, I mean, it was a major operation, as you can imagine. But she, you know, she seemed to be much more coherent in her ability to communicate with us afterwards.
Interesting. How about spiritually or characteristically? Sounds like a lovely woman anyway, so it's hard to see a drastic change personality from someone so lovely.
20 seconds. Can I say something really quick? If you don't know something, instead of saying, well, maybe somebody doesn't remember, best thing is probably to say, I don't know. It really,
yeah.
Otherwise you're just dismissing their experience, and I could just say the same thing about you. Or maybe you just imagine.
Yeah. Well, and I don't want to, you know, everybody's experience is their own. I certainly don't want to be considered an expert on NDE. You know, I just want to tell the stories for sure.
Well,
interesting, Michael, your mom
suggests that this is something other than a physiologic response.
I didn't hear your whole question, Eric. I'm sorry.
I said, is there any research that's been conducted that explains this as anything other than a physiological or physical response?
Anything other than a physiological or physical? Well, no, I don't know of any, Eric. Physiological study and psychological study are in depth and at least 40 years, if not greater, that I could refer you to. But I don't know of any. University of Virginia might be playing with some of what you might be talking about.
What I'm asking, is there a scientific evidence that explains what is the cause of these experiences?
No. No. I don't believe so. That's not my experience. There are several theories, from my understanding, but there is nothing I've ever, there's nothing I've ever sunk my teeth into that I needed to sink my teeth into.
What do you mean that you needed to sink your teeth into?
Well, for me, I like the science aspect of it, but for me, I lived it. So I have a personal experience of that situation. So I read, I don't read a lot of other people's experiences. I don't read anybody's experiences.
So you wouldn't want to, but you wouldn't want to investigate to understand specifically what the cause is, what it is in the views.
I'd love to know. Yes. I would love to know, but it's not something that, that I drive for or push. I guess I drank my own Kool-Aid on what happened to me. But yes, I think to be able to engage other folks to see that magnificence, I want to be able to prove it scientifically or show, not me, but be able to have scientific proof. I think that would be great. But I don't know that that's ever going to happen. I think it still has to be some faith here. And well, some hope and belief.
Hey Eric, we're not trying to get into a debate here, but thanks for joining.
I'm talking. Let me just stay focused on this stuff.
Jumping in here.
Why does there have to be a component of faith? Excuse me. Why does there have to be a component?
Hey, Robert. He popped in by accident and interrupted Michael. So we'll.
Yes, Michael. I can barely see you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. I've got no light on here. Hang on. Let me light me up.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah, sorry about that.
So, yes, your mother's case is very interesting. You've bought some precious time. I think that's special. And those, for me anyway, those were the moments that meant everything, were the time after, a shocking experience like that, that it's that everyday enjoyment or gratitude that for me is everything.
Yeah, I've had extensive conversations with my mother, and she's a devout Catholic. I would call myself a skeptic. So I'm intrigued by, her near-death experience. Mm. So I've had tactful, long conversations about what she went through. Because she's still recovering.
I think that's important to have somebody to talk about. For me, that was one of the striving issues. I even abandoned to a cabin in the mountains for 6 months to try to figure out what was happening to me. So, you do whatever you have to do to find that peace and tranquility in your mind. And, just enjoy each day you have with her. Those are precious, precious.
Oh, yeah. But getting to this.
So happy for you.
The way you're talking, you seem to this experience that you've gone through, you seem to have had some connection with what I would possibly describe as supernatural. Would that be correct? Would I be misreading what you're saying?
And I believe there's a conscious stream of energy in this world. And I believe that every one of us can connect to it. I think you've seen famous people, authors, noted history people who have stood out amongst the crowd, but I believe every one of us has accessibility to that stream of information.
And the experience that you went through, and I didn't get all your story because I came in late, but it was very interesting. I saw this straight away and I jumped in. So I jumped in a little bit late, so.
Best way to do it, somebody.
Forgive me if I've missed half of your story, but
I think once your resonance changes vibratorily, whether that be a near-death experience or a spiritual awakening or a collapse of energy, this is my opinion now, almost like that of a star. as it collapses, that's where you find the springboard to come back from. Some might say rock bottom. I don't know what you want to call it, but it seems like everybody who's had a spiritual awakening had a major collapse of energy, and they're springbound. How they arose from that determined attitude-wise, I think, what they pick up from there.
Yeah. If we can just go back to your experience. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm trying to relate it, you know, in relationship to what I've, the talks I've had with my mother. And, you know, she at no time expressed that she had an experience. She was just in pain. She was delirious. I mean, she was a nurse, so she worked in the medical field prior to having seven children. in her younger years, I mean, she's you know 80 years and 79 years old now. But you know, in her youth, she was a nurse, and then she left the profession. So she comes from a medical background.
Yeah.
Of those days, you know, 60s or 50s, 60s, you know, and here she is. So she has a strong understanding of the medical background of things and how medicine works. And you know, and I approached the questioning, trying to be black and white from a medical perspective. You know, did you feel comfort? Did you feel in pain? You know, were you delirious? You know, and she was very, very, very certain about, you know, no, it was just dark. I was just incoherent. I was the here one minute and not the next. Now, there's all sorts of inferences that could come out of that. And you could say, oh, well, this is that, you know, you could infer this and that. But she was quite strong in her opinion that she understood what she was going through when she was coherent, and when she was, you know, she was in pain, or her brain was working and she could string words or things together in her head, and then it would fall out of place, and she would, you know, go into delirium or whatever her experience was. And I just wonder how that would relate to, you know, your near-death experience that you experienced, and whether that was, you know, whether it could have just been part of the process of lack of oxygen, or just the chemicals in your head moving around, because she's quite convinced that that's what it was. I mean, she's, you know, she's a Catholic, she's very spiritual, you know, we have lots of discussion in our family about religion and stuff, but you know, staying away from that side. But she's very spiritual.
Is she asking these questions, or are you?
Well, it's discussion. I mean, I was asking what she was going through, and she said no, it's very black, you know, it's very, she was very realistic about it, you know, she was very medical about it, if for want of a better word, you know, she was very,
and I get real. Like a lot of people who will talk to me directly about their experience and try to find some synchronicity with others, which I think is a natural instinct. But what I've always said about each everybody's experience, she saw this thing, I saw this thing, you might see something different, and they might see something different. But what I've decided after all the research of 13 million near-death experiencers, some remember, some don't, some didn't have an experience or a perception of experience, some did, some changed, but the majority of them, more than 80%, said their lives were changed dramatically.
I mean, it's obviously, sorry, carry on.
Is whatever experience they do have ends up being exactly what they needed at exactly the right time to bring them to exactly this point of the story. So are they hallucinations? Are they chemical reactions in the brain? I almost want to say, without being trite, who cares? Because whatever happened and whatever caused it was exactly what I needed on a personal level. Some might need to see it being a black expanse. Some might need to see valleys and it, you know, But the healing of it all, the survival, needs to be the gift we look at.
I mean, you hit a really good point there, because when you know, that's a really good point you make, because when you say, you know, you've said now to me, and correct me if I'm wrong here, because I don't want to take it under misunderstand you. You're saying you could have been hallucinating. Okay, it could have just been chemicals.
Yeah.
However, you've gone along this journey, you've come out the other side, and you've had a lot of influence, or a lot of reading, and you've read certain things, articles and influences. So you've come to a conclusion that it is a supernatural experience that you've had.
Yes.
Okay, so
at exactly the right time.
I understand that, and I believe that you believe that. Okay, and however, you've just told me that you don't care whether you believe it or not, and that troubles me, because I, from my position, and I think from anyone that's listening, I think it's really important that we, the people that don't experience these things, I just want to know what the truth is.
Yeah.
And if you've had a real experience, if my mother has missed a real experience or had an experience and hasn't recognized it, all I want to know is what is true about that experience.
Right.
Okay, now,
well, in the I don't care aspect, Michael, I will say it's somewhat of a frustration with the medical doctrine that we've grown up with, that once medicine signs off on something, we all drink the Kool-Aid and we'll all buy into it, and it becomes a standard of our society. But until such a time that medicine can do that, things become skeptical, and here we are. So, you know, I don't ever want it to sound rude to those searching, but, you know, we're searching for an answer maybe none of us are supposed to have. And we all have to have our own experience. I do share mine, and solely because I don't know that it was the experience. I don't know that it was touching what I thought was the face of God. I don't know if it was a hallucination, but what I do know was it happened exactly, I mean, to the second, the moment I needed it. And whatever was in it, whether it be dark, black, white, big, small, or colorful, was exactly what I needed to wake up with the attitude I did, that I'm not going to sit by and let this happen, and I'm not going to waste this opportunity of illness. I'm going to survive. I am loved. But I had to find the hardest thing that all of us have had to find.
Sure, sure.
And that was, I mean, like myself.
Like I say, though, I mean, I don't for a second doubt the sincerity of your belief in your experience, and how could I question it, you know? And only by asking you questions, and this is why I've come on here. I mean, I don't come on here often. You know, you just struck a chord with me, and, you know, in relationship to my mother. And all I want to know is you know, what is true. And I, you know, I come from a skeptical, I was brought up to be skeptical in a sense. so, you know, I just can't help but feel, but, you know, what was the fundamental thing that said, well, it wasn't chemicals to you, and it had to be some sort of, I mean, you talk about this energy and other sorts of factors that involved. I mean, what made you, what drew you to those conclusions that you know, to believe it, what you believe about your experience?
I guess it would have to be an accumulation of things. The after effects and the mannerisms and changes were very confusing to me. they were without effort. And I think about a time where we hire psychologists to change one thing about our personality. And I changed nearly everything about my personality almost overnight. I guess that's where I determined there, you know, this puts me in a, I'll be candid with you about something that I don't normally talk about. What I found in the afterlife, I got to be careful about this. I found that the afterlife was exactly what I thought I deserved. Nothing more and nothing less.
Could you expand on that a bit?
Not much different than our own perception of our own reality here. What you feel you deserve in the afterlife is exactly what you'll see. And to me, whatever, what I experienced was exactly what I needed to experience. It wasn't my time. So to me, understanding that that could be the reason why our near-death experiences vary so much in context, but yet the after effects are so synchronistic and so aligned and so similar that they just scream to pay attention to. But the experiencers all have a different shade of what happened. And it doesn't mean that anything's worse or less for each of their experiences, but it was exactly what they needed to see or to feel. Same for me. And to me, that guides me to the understanding that, you know, whether you want to talk about forgiving yourself, forgiving other people, the moral sins of the biblical times, it all came down to forgiving yourself. Almost everywhere you look.
Do you have a belief in an afterlife and a?
Yes.
I mean, could you just give us a quick definition of what your belief structure is?
I'll give you an analogy.
Yeah,
that will help. And thank you for the question, because I don't get it often, and a lot of times I will avoid it. So I will not do it here, and I will tell you my opinion. I think when you die, your soul expands and emerges and engages with the stream of consciousness that exists all around us. That the fabric you wove during your mortal life, your energy will be more powerful in those areas with those people and with those situations. So your life experiences may, in my opinion, determine your limits in an afterlife. But I think the afterlife will be exactly what you'll expect it to be.
Michael, what do you believe?
I don't know. Is the answer to that? Mm-hmm. That's probably the most honest, and that's why I'm here, to find out. If you tell me something that's convincing enough, I want to know. Yeah,
you know. I think everyone.
There's a lot of people
searching for that question.
That have a lot of answers. But no evidence.
Well, I think, you know,
and this intrigues me, because this is a personal experience that seems so convincing to the person.
Well, and look at science, Michael. When we study gases or things we can't see, it becomes impossible. So what we do scientifically is we inject those materials into water, and we watch and study the bubbles. Those bubbles, on a scientific application, are the after effects of the near-death experience. I don't think it's a mass delusion that the majority of us wake up saying it was the most peaceful experience they'd ever experienced, that it was realer than anything we've ever experienced here, and that we felt that it was limitless, and it was love, and it was pure love.
Yeah, I get very confused. I don't know what your backgrounds are, and I can see you've got a poster in the background of your 20 seconds, which I presume is your experience. You've published it or something. Mm-hmm. I haven't even look you up. So I, you know, like I say, I'm very naive. Forgive me.
You're exploring things you should be exploring. And, you know, these are questions. I think the major question you have has been the question that surrounded us from the beginning of time.
Yeah, I'm just looking for honesty. And you know, I don't for a second, you know, think you're trying to con anyone. I think you're sincere in what you believe.
Ironically,
your experience, you know, you've had time, obviously plenty of time to dwell on it. But you still believe what you believe, and you've come to a conclusion.
I think, Michael, read, and you know, I think you got to read the book, because there's some more to the story that I think will make a difference for you, medically anyway. Some of my story was explaining the impossible and letting you decide for yourself. I didn't try to take any positions in the book other than one thing. That we're more remarkable than we're told, and I'm certain of that one fact.
Yeah, I mean, you know, again, I come from a non-medical background, and I don't pretend to know anything about how the mind works other than my life experience, you know, my own personal thing. So I could just say I think this or I think that, and we are influenced by things around us. We read newspapers that have the Today's Stars in it, and
just being flexible enough to explore and make an educated choice is the key to everything.
Well, I've come to the conclusion that, you know, that the evidence is the paramount thing, and that evidence has to be sound evidence. And if
the irony of our conversation is that I think it's just all about belief.
Well, belief drives our actions, yeah. And if we concluded something and we believe something erroneously, then our actions may also be erroneous, is what I'll say to that. And so you know, if even if we believe something sincerely, you know, and we are absolutely sure within ourselves that our belief is true from a personal perspective, from a subjective point of view.
Well,
if that belief is erroneous, then I could be wrong about something.
What if we agree to agree on this, that if we just believe in anything is possible?
It's about following your heart, your inner discernment, your inner intuition. What feels, when you hear the information, does it feel good? Does it resonate with you? You know, there's a lot of discernment and your own inner guidance that connects you to the information that feels right for you.
And that's why there's so many different religions throughout the world. And if you think about that, that's just a belief too. A human wrote a book, and if your intuition and your guidance tells you to believe that, and this is what I'm going to follow, and it brings you happiness and joy and gives you purpose and direction in life.
You know, it's
a good thing.
Michael, a lot of your questions, believe it or not, will be answered in the book.
I mean, I believe that people believe things, and that makes them feel a certain way, and that can be comforting. It doesn't make those beliefs true. And my point is I want to believe what's true. If my mother, when she went through her experience, if she went through an experience that she missed out on the truthness, let's say, of what, if your point of view is true, okay, and there is some sort of supernatural afterlife or connection to another dimension or whatever, however you describe it, I want to know about it.
Yeah.
But my mother is mistaken, because she doesn't believe what she believes and what she's expressed. So, you know, so somebody's wrong here. Somebody's mistaken. Somebody's misinformed. Somebody's belief is causing their actions to be erroneous.
Could be.
And Michael, if you have some time and you ever get on a YouTube binge, YouTube, Abraham Hicks and Bashar and a couple of channelers, and they go into the afterlife and belief system and structures and how your thoughts reflect your reality and produce your reality. It's pretty interesting stuff. And you have to just use your own discernment.
I get very skeptical about people who think they can channel, and I don't want to get into a discussion about it because that's I'm talking about a personal thing here. And to Robert as well, it's personal.
What I think is important to note for many, and what I noticed is my high school biology just isn't cutting it, and a lot's changing since the internet. According to society, science is doubling their information every day for the past 2 years since the start of the internet. So those questions you have may never be answered, but there is some fairly sound research that you should look at, and that is University of Virginia. PMH Atwater has done 40 years of research on near-death experiencers, including children. She's a child of a former police officer, so she's an incredible investigator. And now you have some colleges doing fundamental conscious research that I certainly avail you to, because I'll tell you, it'll blow your mind.
Yeah,
and we'll answer some of your questions here.
Can I just ask you one more question, and I'll go, because I've sucked up too much time here.
No worries.
If science is developing, every day, getting better and better, and they there's this what they call this God helmet thing that they're talking about now, and they've had these Buddhist monks come in, and they can read their brain waves and measure their brain frequencies. I mean, and there's this what they call the God helmet, which is the same. Instead of measuring, it actually applies electromagnetic. I don't know how it works. I'm not going to pretend to know. But basically, this helmet or this thing they stick on your head. What it does is it applies some electromagnetic waves across through into the brain.
Yeah.
And it affects your brain waves and the way you think.
Yes.
On a conscious level.
And they said they've almost recreated a near-death experience.
Yeah, right. Okay. And that's what I was leading to. Now, if at some point in the future, they could accurately replicate your near-death experience, so you could walk in there and have exactly what you had.
Yes.
Okay. And they turn around and say, "Well, this is because this X, Y, and Z." Would that change your opinion about your supernatural beliefs point of view?
No. I think that's, I want science to prove some things for other people. I don't need science to prove it for me. But I do recognize that if I'm going to stand up and tell the world they're magnificent, I'd like them to catch up with, a couple thousand years of Buddhist beliefs and theologies that have been going on since the beginning of time. What is hard to argue here is biology, and biology has changed and evolved much faster than we understand. And I think that's probably one of the best things I could recommend for most people, is understanding biology now. It's changed. So I wish you luck on your journey, finding you're looking for what many probably are. I'm sorry I'm not looking for it. I'd be happy to find it again.
Yeah. So are you satisfied with what you believe where you are is the end of the journey? You believe that there is no more to discover
after that, after death?
well, from your experience, you believe you've come to a conclusion, which often must if you're from your side, must just raise another set of questions. Surely.
Yeah. Well, it builds an excitement for me because I don't exactly know what's going to happen, but I have a general foundation from being there, and I'm excited to be back there. But I don't think death, you know, I hate the fact we even labeled it death. I don't see it as death. I see it as a reborn. And until we understand that and the magnificence on that side, what we can do and how we absorb into the energy all around us every day, boy, you know, that's really kind of been the calling for me. Is I don't need science to explain it. I'd love it to explain it for you, though.
Right. I appreciate your time. I really, really do. It's been
thank you.
Really, 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 no, it's been good to talk. If you can just, I would just, you know, leave you with this thought that you know, is it possible that you could be mistaken in some way? And I'm sure you think about that all the time, because, you know, any sensible person would.
Yeah. Well, I think anything's possible. So, you know, I never want to take a position on anything. I want to take an interest. I find it's too hard evolving defending a position. So in my book, if you will read it and do me the honor, you'll see that I don't take a position. I just take an interest in telling the story. And I leave it to you to determine from there.
All right. Okay. Thanks for your time. I'll pop off and let someone else jump in. Okay. Cheers, guys.
All right, Michael.
Okay. Cheers.
Thank you,
Michael. Thanks so much for your time. Bye. Thanks for jumping on. We appreciate it.
Take care, Michael. Thank you. Robert, thanks for taking on such a
those are big questions, you know. You're not going to be able to answer all those.
They're big questions.
It's okay.
I just wanted to say one thing that kept popping in my head, and it resonates with me because everyone wants to, a lot of people want the facts and they want to prove things. And I use the example, for me at least, like love, for example, like you can't see it, you can't prove it, you can't feel it, you can't see it under a microscope, but you know it when it's there. Like if you love someone, you feel that connection. There's so many things in the world that maybe they're not supposed to be factual or proven. And maybe it's supposed to be part of our own awakening, connecting with our intuition, our discernment. And I think that as much as we try to scientifically analyze, there may be certain things that are never meant
maybe
to have that.
Maybe those are the moments of time, the cosmic humor of it all, that is just to remind you how powerful the word belief is. Not proof, belief. Mm-hmm. Your mind is not going to see what it's not prepared to see. So I believe crossing that threshold of possibility, ironically, means you have to think a little different than the average. You know what I mean? You always have to stand out and maybe mm-hmm. get thrown stones at you, or people, oh, he's weird or what. I just think that's the cosmic humor. For me to be able to see what I see and feel what I feel, I have to be different. And I'm okay with it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you did a great job dealing with those questions. I mean, it's great to hear different perspectives and the questions that people are stirring in their minds, you know, but you did a great
point them back to positives. You know, it's too hard answering any negatives on anything. So if you keep it light, I think it works better. So.
So Robert, where can everyone?
Well, they can certainly get it on Amazon or Barnes and Nobles. It is a worldwide distribution. We have it on our website, 20seconds.net, for a discounted price, and it's personalized and autographed if you make notes accordingly. So that's the same price, if not a little cheaper than Amazon. It's funny, Amazon has a great following, so wherever you want to find it, it's fine. But we've been in that top 1% in Amazon since we started, so we're enjoying that too. So.
I wanted to show everyone, there's a dash.
There is.
Right? Yeah. So like 20 dash seconds.
That's perfect.
Can you read it? Okay, that's where, the, you know, his website, and you can get a link to this Amazon book.
Yeah, so go check that out and go over to vibrationupgrade.com, and we just have a work with us section and a comment section below if any of you guys want us to bring on other people to speak about different topics, let us know on our website. We also have a free guide on there. It's the ascension tips and tools we use to help raise our vibrations, some food and essential oils and things that Aaron's put together to just help raise your vibration as we're changing into the higher realms here. So,
but if anyone had any other questions for you, I mean, on your website, is there a way they could get a hold of you or ask questions?
I have several sites on Facebook as well that people communicate mostly with, and of course, Twitter and Instagram and LinkedIn. So, but on my website, there is a contact me, and I do usually get 3 or 4 a day questions. So absolutely welcome. And I try to get back to everybody myself.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, it was
fun. Yes, it was. I was so glad to do it this way. I can't wait to tell other friends because this is clever. I've always said that it's not about just telling my experience. It's getting others involved and communicating, and that's how you collaborate. So fantastic, fantastic avenue. You guys did a great job. I'm so grateful.
Yeah, and, you know, it's just nice to have kind of everyone involved. You know, you can see the questions. They can
still
come on.
Firing.
I don't know. It's they're
right.
Still
anytime,
firing.
You guys. I'd love to.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
We'll
take stay
care
in touch.
Of yourself.
You know, the universe.
Thank you for including me. You're doing great work.
You too.
Take care.
Oh, thanks, you too. Robert. Thanks, Robert. We'll talk to you.
Thanks, everyone, for watching.
Bye, everyone.